Okay, hey, welcome to another episode of Fire Science Friday. So today we're doing the last of the five series, right? What is fire? We talked about what fire was. We talked about the three things it needed. We talked about heat, oxygen, and fuel. Now we're going to talk about living with it, right? So when we look throughout history, there's been cities all over the world that have actually suffered from fires. One of the first ones that that's kind of been recorded happened in Rome in 64 AD. Emperor Nero is said to have been fiddling while Rome burned. So that's kind of a big deal, right? So ever since that period of time, we've been dealing with fire in our communities. In Chicago, they had a big fire in 1871. That's 6 years after Lincoln, or I'm sorry, yeah, 6 years after Lincoln had been killed. So this was right after the Civil War. The town had this massive fire. 17,000 buildings were burned up, and over 300 people died. And then if we go into our own community in Spokane, back in 1889, which is 100 years after the day that I graduated, 100 years later, so that's how old I am, they had a big fire in Spokane, too. Both in Chicago and in Spokane, one thing they used to try to fight the fire was dynamite. Wait a minute. Did I just say dynamite? Yes, dynamite. Imagine this, right? So you have a bunch of buildings in downtown Spokane. And they're all lined up like this. And that day of that fire, there was a huge, huge problem. A couple of them, actually. The first one was the city pumps weren't working that good, so they didn't have enough water. And the other thing was there was a big windstorm that day, right? So as the fire is progressing, it's burning up buildings. So the fire's shooting out of this one right here, and over here on this side is where the building used to be, and now there's a little fire there. So the fire is moving this direction. So what they do is they put dynamite in this building, and they blow it up, trying to stop the fire to go to the next building. Dynamite to try to fight fire, right? So because of all these fires that we've had in our history, right, in the United States, we had Chicago, we had San Francisco, we had Spokane, most towns, most major towns had big fires. So we had to learn to live with it, right? We had to do some things. So what we're gonna do is we're gonna show you some of the things that kind of help keep us safe. We're gonna talk about how they work, and we're gonna hopefully try to avoid these fires, these massive conflagrations in the future, right? Because of the fire codes, right? So let's wheel around. Let's go over here. We're gonna look at this table over here. One of the biggest things that helped when it comes to having fires contained inside of a building is what we used to put on the walls. Back in the old days, wood was a very common thing to put on the walls, right? Every building was made of wood. They had wood exteriors, wood interiors. We know wood burns really well, right? It wouldn't be Fire Science Friday without lighting something on fire, right? So let's show you how this works. Torch, and we put the fire on there. It's gonna turn dark, it's gonna turn dark, it's gonna turn dark. Look at that, smokes, and it burns, right? So this is not a good thing to build a building of inside, right? Because the fire inside is gonna spread real good. What we've gone to, first we went to something called lath and plaster. Plaster, just like it sounds, is a cement-like product, and they smeared it over the wood so it kept the wood safe. Fast forward a little bit, and we came up with this new product called gypsum board. Some brand names, drywall, sheetrock, all brand names, but gypsum board. Gypsum is a product, it's almost like a chalk-like substance. All right, watch this. We're gonna take a little bit of gypsum, and we're gonna try to light it on fire. All right, there's the gypsum. We'll put that right on there. See that? Barely even changed color. So when we talk about how we build buildings, we make them safer, right? We make them a lot safer today. This product, this particular product right here, amazing. You close your door at night and you have this kind of wall in your house, and that fire will stay on the other side of that door and that wall. This stuff is absolutely amazing for keeping fires into rooms. And that helps us as firefighters put it out. So a couple neat things have happened over the years, right? In a lot of cities, they made buildings of brick. Does brick burn? No, but the stuff inside didn't, right? So they didn't have the proper finishes inside. So once the fire got inside the building, it took everything out on the inside and the bricks just fall down. So construction is a big deal these days. We've actually come a long ways in saving lives and protecting property by making buildings better than we did back when Nero was fiddling in Rome in 64 AD, right? A couple other things that have really made a big difference in our world. Smoke detectors. okay? There are two main kind of smoke detectors. The first one we're gonna talk about is ionization. H? No, it's an I, right? Ionization. This is what it looks like when you break it apart. So this guy right here, that's your horn. That's gonna go beep, 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 right? This right here, that's your chamber. And the way this works is the battery powers and completes a circuit in here, right? So you have a low voltage circuit as the power runs through this, and as that circuit is complete, it just runs normally, right? But once you introduce smoke or steam into this, that breaks that circuit and that sets off the alarm. So this little device right here, you can see it, there's little holes all right there. Air goes in there, smoke goes in there, and when it gets in there, it stops that electric current and causes this to go beep, beep, beep. So this is a very neat smoke detector, really common. Most smoke detectors out there are like this. Works really well. One thing about this one though, it will go off with steam. So you don't want to put an ionization smoke detector in the hallway right by the bathroom, because you open the door after you take a shower, all the steam goes out, sets off the alarm. And when that happens, people take them down. They don't do any good when they're in a drawer. So we want to make sure we put them in the right place, right? Anyway, these things work really good for fast moving fires, right? They catch that fire and they activate really quick. There's another version out there. P, does anybody know what that stands for? Photoelectric, you're right, good job. Photoelectric. Now look at the difference here. It's kind of crazy, they look a little bit different, don't they? Here's the deal, we had to take this one apart a little bit further. So we take the circuit board out, and when we get it on the other side, this is the magic right here. That little device right there, it works off of light. So it has an emitter and a receiver, and it shoots a beam across there. When smoke is introduced to that environment, it breaks that beam up, and it causes the alarm to go into activation. So this one works really well on smoldering fires. Most fires in homes start from smoldering fires, right? Except for kitchen fires, right? Then we got oil and everything. But most fires in a home starts from smoldering. When you talk about electricity starting a fire, typically there's a smoldering aspect that goes on. You talk about cigarettes starting a fire, typically there's a smoldering. So these are really good smoke detectors. They don't work as well for rapidly moving fires, but they go off. These are good smoke detectors. They work in all environments. They're better at the smoldering fire than the ionization. So there's two different kinds. Most people will recommend that you get, do you want to hang up two smoke detectors? Seems weird. Why don't you get one smoke detector that does both? They make them, right? So they'll actually detect smoke with both technologies. Those are a little bit more money, but if you want to be completely, fully, 100%, 99%, guaranteed that they're going to work, get the kind that does both, right? Awesome. Remember I just said 99%? Let me ask you a question. I think I asked you this probably the first time we had this show. How many of you are willing to bet your life that this smoke detector is going to work when you need it to? Not this one, obviously. It's all apart. But one that's all together. Are you willing to bet your life? I've got 10 smoke detectors in my house. I'm not willing to bet my life that they're going to work and save my life. What I'm going to do is some other things to help keep me safe, right? I'm going to make sure that the candles are blown out. I'm going to make sure that the heaters are disconnected. I'm going to make sure the doors are closed. I'm going to make sure my house is safe before I go to bed. And I'm going to have those smoke detectors there just in case. So smoke detectors are awesome. Test them. We test them once a month, right? If we can change the battery, we change the battery twice every year, right? But nowadays, some of these new smoke detectors, they come with a battery built in. You never have to change it. After 10 years, you throw it away. Throw it away. Right? That reminds me, you need to find out how old your batteries are. I'm sorry, not your batteries, your smoke detector. On the back of this smoke detector, it actually gives you a date. Right there, I'm gonna read it to you. It says, hold on, my arms need to be longer. 2007, this is a 2007 smoke detector. So this is over 10 years old. It's no good anymore, right? We gotta get rid of them after 10 years. That makes sure, I mean, it's a cheap form of insurance, right? So just replace them after 10 years. And if you get a chance, buy the kind that does both, right? But if you can't afford both, then just get one, right? Just have one, right? All right, so smoke detectors have done an amazing job at saving lives in the United States. Here's the thing, folks. You gotta have them installed and you gotta have a battery in them, otherwise they don't do any good, right? So make sure you do that sort of thing, okay? We also have fire alarms. Did you guys see that? I was trying to give it to you. I was trying to see if you could catch it, and you guys failed me miserably. Fire alarms, right? You guys have seen these in your schools probably. How many of you have ever wondered how they work? Obviously, the big concept here is you pull and the alarm goes off, right? Well, here's how it looks inside. There's a little button right there, right? If you take this thing off and push that button, it does the same thing as pulling the lever. Inside there, I'm gonna turn this around here so you can see it a little better. See that little arm right there? When I pull the lever down, that little arm moves. And when that moves, it activates the button right here. And when that happens at a school, here's how this works. Someone pulls the alarm, fire alarm goes off. Somebody calls 911 and says, hey, there's a fire alarm going off at this school. So what happens for our department is we send two fire trucks, minimum, because there's a school and there's an alarm. Somebody might be in danger, so we're gonna send two fire trucks. Do you think the fire truck drives the speed limit to the school? Or do they go a little faster? They go a little faster, right? Now, every time a fire truck goes a little faster, we take very good care of how we're driving that vehicle. We're trained how to drive that vehicle, but sometimes bad things happen. So if you pull this alarm, two fire trucks are coming. Those two fire trucks can't help anybody else because they got to go to the school. Have to. While they're going to that school, let's say someone has a heart attack. Fire trucks are still going to that school. They have to go to that school. Somebody has a diabetic emergency. Somebody has a stroke. Those two trucks have to go there. They can't divert. They can't go help. Right? So if you pull this for the fun of it, you could be endangering someone's life that needs medical attention. If you pull this, those two fire trucks are going to drive to the scene. Sometimes bad things happen when those trucks are going down the road. Several years ago, before I became a firefighter in our department, there was an accident. A car hit a fire truck. The person in the car died. All across America, when these trucks are going down the road, sometimes bad things happen. So when you pull one of these for the fun of it or to get out of a test, bad things can happen. You need to make sure you understand that. You need to think about the consequences of your actions before you actually commit the problem, right? Pulling these for no good reason is not okay. If there's a fire, absolutely pull the alarm. If you just want to get out of a test, you should have called in sick. You don't want this sort of thing to go on your record. Actually, did you know this, that when you pull this for the fun of it, it's actually a crime in the state of Washington? Tampering with a fire protection system is a crime. Right? So these things right here, they're an important tool. They get people out of a building. They keep people safe. But if you misuse them, it's a problem. You notice I said the same thing about smoke detectors? They're amazing. They work great. But if you don't use them right, they don't work. If you don't use these right, they don't work. Do you see the weak link in all this stuff? It's us. It's people. We're the problem. Right? This stuff actually does a good job as long as we follow the directions. Right? So these things are awesome. But you gotta make sure you don't pull them for the fun of it. If you do that and I catch you, oh boy, you're gonna be in trouble. Anyway, think about what I just said there. Lots of things happen when you pull that. If you pull it for the fun of it, bad things can happen. And you don't wanna be responsible for somebody dying. I know I don't, right? All right, another thing that's really been cool, I mean, just awesome, fire sprinkler systems, right? And there's lots of different fire sprinklers. If you go to your school, most often you look up, there's gonna be these little things looking like this, right? Little sprinkler heads, right? Some of them are kind of tiny and small like this. Some of them look like that right there, okay? This one is bigger than your garden hose. That is 1 inch diameter right there. Do you know that there's a building in Spokane County that has 40,000 of these things installed? That's a lot. And they cost about $90 a piece. So do the math, 40,000 times $90. Millions, right? These things are amazing. The reason why they put them in buildings is because they save lives and protect property. Today, we're actually gonna go shoot one off. It's gonna be awesome, you guys are gonna love it. Because it wouldn't be fire science without lighting someone on fire, right? Hey, so a couple things. Remember I talked about in society, back in the old days, stuff burned up and everything like that? In today's world, we have 911, right? We know how to call 911, right? We pick up the phone, we dial 911. And it goes to this dispatcher and he decides, or she decides, is it a fire or is it a police emergency? And then the appropriate units are dispatched. 911 is kind of not a universal thing, but in the United States, it's everywhere. In China, when I went to China and visited, the number was actually 119. Kind of weird. But That's also one of those tools that we have, right? We can get the news out faster about a fire burning. So just the fact that we have a phone is an amazing safety thing, right? We can call 911 when we have to. So it's the alarm systems, the sprinkler systems, all part of the safety system, right? All part of living with fire. If you see smoke and you want to call 911, that's great. But get as much information as you can. Don't just keep on driving, right? So if the fire crews come, you can show them where it's at. A lot of times we'll get a call from somebody on a highway. They'll say, I saw smoke over here. Fire trucks go racing around looking for smoke all over the place. We call dispatch and say, hey, we can't find it. Can you call the people back and ask them where they saw it at? And then they can't get a hold of you. If you call 911, keep your phone available. Make sure you can answer that call when they call you back, because we sometimes need help, right? You see a little bit of smoke and you call 911, but when we get there, the smoke's gone. It's hard for us to find that stuff. So your phone is an important tool to call 911. It's an important tool to get us there so we can actually make the situation safer, right? But if it's not used properly, it doesn't work very well. So again, 911 is what we call when there's an emergency. Do we call 911 when our pizza arrives at our house cold? No, we don't do that. We got a phone call there. Did you see that? It's kind of cool. All right. So what we're gonna do is we talked about interior construction. We talked about the stuff we use. Now we're gonna show you this really cool prop that I built. You gotta use your imagination on this, all right? It's really important you use your imagination on this. So we're gonna grab this right here. I'm gonna hand this over to my partner, and we're gonna show you some really cool stuff over here. Okay, so what we have here, this is a pretend house, right? So yes, I built this in my garage, and no, it's not for dolls. And even if it was, you can't make fun of me, all right? We have our door coming in, we have windows, right? Window, there's a bedroom here, there's a big long hallway, right? We're gonna get up here, we're gonna take a look at it. What I'm gonna do is, we've got a pot of water in here, right? See, water. We're gonna set it in here. And the house is upside down for a very good reason. We are gonna use, a little dry ice to make our smoke. We're gonna add a little bit of food coloring to the water. Do you guys know why I'm doing it? Adding a little food color to it? It's really important. It just looks cool. It has nothing to do with the experiment, but I like blue water, right? So we mix it up a little bit so our water's nice and blue. It almost looks like the water in the moat around It's a Small World down in Disneyland. Or Pirates of the Caribbean, right? So, what we're gonna do is we're gonna take the dry ice out of this bag right here. Is dry ice something you wanna play with? Well, you gotta understand that dry ice can be a real dangerous thing because it's so cold, it can actually freeze your skin. So you don't wanna actually just grab this stuff willy-nilly, you wanna use gloves. By the way, you can get this stuff at your local grocery store, so if you want to do these kind of experiments at home, make sure your parents are with you, make sure they know what's going on, and make sure you wear gloves and proper protection, right? So we're going to take a piece of this dry ice. Look at that, smoking, right? It's kind of cool. And we're going to drop it in this water right here, and we're going to get it to bubble. Bubble, bubble, boiling trouble. See all the bubbles boiling? Now, use your imagination here. This is our living room. There's a fire in the living room, and this is smoke. It's starting to build up. And now it's starting to move down the hallway. And this bedroom back here in the back, smoke's starting to come in here. It's starting to roll over. The people that live in this house did not close their door. Now let's come back here in the living room. Look at what's going on here. The smoke's now building up. Look at the line right here. See that way, the level of smoke in that room? One of the reasons why we teach kids to check a door before they leave is to make sure it's not hot. The reason why we tell you to get down low to the ground is because smoke does this in your room, right? It starts to layer. We can crawl out from underneath this and not get in the smoke. Look at it building up there. You guys see that layering? Look at that, woo. It's kind of cool, right? Go to the door, see it there? See how it's getting kind of high there? As it fills up, it goes down the hallway. And now we got smoke in this back bedroom. See that there? You see it woofing up there? So smoke's in the bedroom now. Now let's go to the middle room. The door's closed in here. There's no smoke, right? Now let's look up from the top. Look what's going on in there. There's no smoke in there, right? That's the neat thing about understanding why we close doors, is because if we close the door, we keep this oxygen in here, we save it for us. It doesn't belong to the fire, it's ours. But back here in this room, smoke's in there, right? That's because we left the door open. Let's put some more ice in. Let's fill it up. We're gonna fill her up. Watch this. We're gonna show you the door closed too, right? So check this out, check it outers. This is our door. We're gonna bring it in here. We're gonna shut this room off. Right? And we're gonna get all the smoke out of there real quick. Now look, no smoke in there. And look what's happening back behind the door. It's all building up, right? Watch what happens when I open the door for a second. All the smoke comes rushing in. Do you guys see that? Let's tilt that camera up a little bit more. We'll get a little bit better angle here. So we'll take all the smoke out. Right? We check the door. It's not hot. We open the door to see what's going on. All that smoke coming rushing into that building. All that smoke coming rushing into that room. We just realized that the house is full of smoke. We need to keep that door shut. We need to think about getting out in a separate way because there's too much smoke out there, right? When it rushes in like that, that's a bad thing. We got a big problem out there. Again, this room right here, no smoke. This room right here, we open the door, we got smoke in there. We'll try that one more time because it's actually kind of cool. All right, let's see if we can look up just a little bit more, angle the phone this way and point down. All right, so we're gonna open this door. Watch it roll in. See it just pour right into that room? This is an awesome experiment. It shows exactly how it would work. It's just upside down. So use your imagination here, right? Smoke goes to the ceiling. Smoke stays in compartments when doors are closed. If we open compartments up, smoke's gonna come into those compartments. So we need to always have another way out of our house. We have to have an escape plan. We have to practice that stuff. Make sense to you guys? We gotta have a plan. A wise man once told me, people don't plan to fail. People fail to have a plan. In the Marine Corps, we talked about having a plan for everything. We also said this, it rarely survives first contact. And what I mean by that is, when you have a plan to take a hill or to take a town or whatever, it's a good plan. But when people start shooting at you, you gotta change the plan sometimes. You always have to have a backup plan. You have to think about how am I gonna get out? And you need to think about it before it happens because when the emergency's there, you don't have time to think. You actually stop thinking very clearly. You stop thinking clearly when there's an emergency happening. The blood's rushing through your body. You don't think very well. So if you have a plan and you practice your plan, you're more likely to get out safely. Smoke like this in a house, very dangerous. Most people actually die from the smoke. They don't die from fire. And it's because you can't breathe, right? So understanding, keep your doors closed, make sure your smoke detectors work, make sure you have an escape plan, you know where you're gonna meet. When you go to bed at night, if you have a phone, keep it in your room with you, right? You can call 911 from anywhere with a cell phone. Make sure you know your address. All key critical stuff to staying safe, right? Smoke detectors are great, but they're not the only piece to the puzzle. You're the biggest piece to the puzzle. And the most important piece, the most important thing you got is what's going on up here. Let's use it before we have to really worry about it, right? Let's think about the process. So that is really cool. I'm hoping you got a good view of it because I think this is one of those neat experiments that just really shows how smoke goes through a house, right? Wicked cool. All right, so here's what we're gonna do. We got a little bit more time. What we're gonna do is we're gonna go out in the shop and I'm gonna show you how fire sprinklers work, okay? These things are awesome. First, we gotta put this away because it's $1.69 a pound. By the way, Julie's paying for it, just saying. Okay, let's go out in the shop. Let's light something on fire. Dry ice, put away, right in the freezer. Let's go have some fun. We're entering Wayne's world. Today, Josh is here, super mechanic. He actually helped set up a lot of this, so it's gonna be really cool. Let's come take a look. There's guys training out there, so we can't disturb them. I'm just kidding. We don't want them to disturb us, right? Okay, so here's what's gonna happen, ladies and gentlemen. I wanna show you this one little part here. So when I was practicing this, I was actually at my house and my neighbor girls came over, Lulu and Glory. They came over and they were helping me watch set this up, right? And so they had a whole bunch of questions about alarm systems and sprinkler systems and everything like that. Glory asked me, so if the sprinkler goes off, does it call 911? And I said, yes, it does. And here's how that works. This is called a flow switch. This is actually sits in a big pipe like this. So it sits just like that, right? And when this little paddle, when the water starts to move, that paddle gets pushed, and watch this. See that? Once water hits this switch, an alarm goes off. That alarm tells everybody in the building that there's a possibility of a fire, the sprinkler system's going off, and it also calls 911. So again, fire trucks come and see what's going on. So anyway, by the way, Josh from the shop, he did this, so I got an alarm, right? That's awesome. That's how that works. Electricity, right? Switch, alarm. It's kind of cool. Now, we're gonna disconnect this real quick so we don't actually start. We don't want this going off while we're doing our actual fire test. And again, we actually have a fire extinguisher, sprinkler system. Make sure we stay safe. So we're gonna take this sprinkler system. We got three different types of heads up here. Let's take a closer look at these heads real quick, okay? So here's what we got. This one right here is actually something that's gonna go into the wall. It's gonna come out of a wall. It's called a side mount, right? It shoots water straight across the room. This one right here is the most common one we have out there in the market probably. It has a little red bulb in there, and that bulb has a liquid. Typically it's glycerin. And when it gets to 155 degrees, that glass bubble breaks. A blocker comes out and water flows. So we're gonna light a fire here. We're gonna get this to go off and it's gonna shoot water. And then the last one we have up here today, this is called an upright. If you notice, this right here, it looks like a little umbrella. Water will shoot up, hit the umbrella, and then come back down on the ground. So these are designed to stick straight up. These ones right here are designed to point down. And those ones right there are designed to shoot out from the wall. Right? So we're gonna hook this up here and we're gonna scoot this back just a little bit. I mean, technically it's not my phone. I really shouldn't worry too much about it, right? Anyway, so we already have water hooked up. We've got our ignition source. We need a little bit of fuel to get this to burn. And here we go, we're gonna demonstrate the use of the sprinkler system and how it works. Here's the thing, when these things are installed, you don't have to do anything. They go off all by themselves. You guys have seen TV shows, right? In the movies, when one of these things goes off, they all go off. Not even close to being true. Typically in a fire that's being controlled by a sprinkler system, three or less are going off. If we have more than three going off, there's not enough water typically to supply everything. So it's really a problem when a whole bunch of them go off. We want as few as possible, and so that's how they're designed, as few as possible. So let's set a fire and see if this thing puts it out. Oh boy, here we go. Time to get wet. Watch carefully. Did you see that? It put it out all by itself. Now you see that one head's going off, right? It's going pretty good. If we set off this other head, we're gonna get more water, right? Let's see if we can set that other one off. This time we're just gonna use a torch though. All right, I'm gonna put my glasses on because the sparks might shoot out of this one. So as we heat this up, it's gonna melt a piece of metal in there and it's gonna cause it to shoot. Look at that. You see that right there? The second one's going off. Did you notice the first head, when the second went off, less water came out of the first one? Now watch this one. It's just trickling out now. You see what I mean when I say that they aren't designed for all of them to go off? There's just not enough water in the system. Usually three. This particular setup here doesn't have a lot of pressure like a real system, so it's kind of just flowing out kind of silly, right? Sprinkler systems work amazingly. They are absolutely amazing. They work, they save lives. This is a little bit of information for you. In a building that has a sprinkler system that was properly installed and it's properly maintained, there's never been a person that's died in that building. Now, that excludes explosions, because explosions are just bad things all around. But in a typical fire, in a typical building, these things, they work, okay? Small story. So we had an apartment complex down on Sprague Avenue. I'm sorry, it was a hotel, motel. And a guy comes in, and he takes his briefcase and he sets it on top of the stove. This little unit had a kitchen in it. Well, he bumped the switch and he turned it on. He left, stove on, suitcase on top of the stove, it starts a fire. One of these heads goes off, controls the fire. Fire crews go there, they find the room that's got a problem, they shut the sprinklers off, they do a little cleaning, they put a plug in that head, and everybody else got to stay in that hotel that night. If that wouldn't have been there, there would have been a big fire, and everybody would have been having to look for someplace else to stay. But because that sprinkler system was there, it saved the entire building. They cost a little bit of money, I get that, but they are absolutely amazing at saving lives and property. So when you look at fire sprinkler systems, just think of them as something out there that's really important. Now, that being said, should you play with those things? Should you go and poke at them? No, because if you do that, those things are gonna go off, and when we get there, we're gonna have no problem finding you. Do you know why I say it like that? Because you're gonna be the one that's all wet, right? We'll know who you are. Why is that guy all wet? Oh, because he's the one that hit the head, right? So just understand what they are, how they work, and don't play with them, right? They're there for very important things. Do you hang stuff from these heads? No, you don't. Now, these are just three types. There are literally hundreds of types out there. There's ones that are recessed, and there's ones that are covered with these decorative plates. They're all out there, and they're all designed to work. So just know that they're there, but don't take it for granted, right? Because we don't want them to go off. We still don't want a fire in our house or in our apartment. Just know that they're there, okay? It actually would help me sleep better if I knew that those things were in my house. I don't have them. My house is old. Long story. Anyway. So take a look at this. Look how much water's in there. Do you think I'm gonna be able to get that to start up again? My whole experiment's ruined. I'm just kidding. It was the experiment. Look at that. How cool is that? Anyway, those are the kind of things I want you to understand, right? There's lots of different things out there that can help keep us safe, but we have to use our brain too. We just can't rely on them, right? It isn't a one and done kind of thing. We constantly need to be thinking about how we're gonna keep fires from happening in our house. So let's talk about some of the common ways fire starts. One, cooking. Remember that episode I showed you about heat, right? I had the pot out there with oil in it. I turned it on high, I let it sit there, and when it got to 700 degrees, it started on fire. And then I was being a dork and I was putting the lid off and on, telling you need to keep the lid on there all the time. And we had a big fire. So cooking is one of those things that starts fires in homes all the time. Another thing, when we talked about electricity, we talked about taking a space heater and plugging it into an extension cord. We showed you the cord all wrapped up and how it retained that heat, right? That's a problem. Heaters, read the owner's manual. It'll tell you, do not use an extension cord. So if we misuse electricity, it can be a problem for us. So that could be a problem. Hey, how about this? I had a friend of mine out of District 3, his name's Tim. He sent me an email and said, hey Rick, I know, you know, I took that class from you on fire investigation and you mentioned that fans in bathroom ceilings can be a problem. We just had a fire out in District 3 that a fan in a ceiling started it, he said. I sent him an email back and said, you know what, you're absolutely right, it is a problem. I've probably been to 20 of those types of fires in my career. The fans in the bathroom, what happens is, nobody cleans them, right, and they run forever, and so they get all built up with gook, and then they fail, and that when those motors stop turning, they create heat and they start a fire. If you have a bathroom fan, it's important to turn it on for lots of different reasons, right? Get humidity out of the room, get other stuff out of the room, right? But you gotta make sure you shut them off. You can't let them run 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. In my home, when I did a remodel of my bathroom, I have a fan, I put a timer on it. That timer, I hit it, runs for 30 minutes, then it shuts off. If you don't have a timer on your bathroom fan, I highly recommend you get one. Bathroom fans are designed to get rid of stuff in the bathroom that doesn't smell good or that's wet, right? But we need to make sure we shut them down on a regular basis. If you don't have one of those timers, that's okay. Just remember to turn it off, okay? Run it for 15, 20 minutes and then shut it off. But don't leave them running all the time. So bathroom fans, big problem. So we got cooking, we got candles. Candles can be a problem, right? We gotta make sure that if we're using candles, we're using it on a dish that's fireproof. We don't wanna use it on a piece of plastic. We don't wanna put it directly onto a wood bookshelf, right? We wanna make sure we're on a plate, something like that. So candles are a problem. So I call it the three C's, right? We got cooking, candles, and kids. Okay, two C's and a K. But kids are a problem. I hate to tell you guys this, but kids start fires all the time. They're experimenting when they shouldn't be, right? They're doing stuff they shouldn't be doing. So kids are a problem. Cooking, kids, electricity, space heaters, those are big problems that we have out there in the community. So if you cook, stay in the kitchen. Make sure you have a lid that you can cover up the pot with. If you have little brothers and sisters, keep the matches and lighters away from them. I've had three-year-olds actually start fires in my career. I've interviewed three-year-olds and they've told me that they started the fire. So think about that stuff, you know? All it takes to prevent a fire is just a little bit of thought and a little bit of action. I'm not asking you to move the earth, right? I'm just asking you to put away a lighter. If you do those things, good things happen. So we've gone about 40 minutes here, 35 minutes, 40 minutes. This is gonna be the last episode of our five-part series. We're thinking of some other things that we wanna do. We're definitely gonna try to maintain our presence here on Facebook Live. At noon today, Assistant Fire Marshal Brent Anderson will be talking with Guy from DNR. They're gonna be talking about wildland fire preparedness. That's gonna be at noon, Facebook Live. Make sure you tune in there if you live out in the woods, and you can learn some great tips on how to keep your house safe from wildfires. So we're gonna constantly be doing this. We're hopefully gonna be coming out with some medical stuff. We'll talk about heart attacks and strokes and what we do on that end of it. Lots of stuff coming in the future. Thank you so much for watching. If you have questions, please submit them. I'll look at the crowd here and see if anybody has any questions I can answer right now. Okay, you guys are awesome. Oh, last thing. You're here watching this on Facebook Live, or you're watching it on Spokane Valley Fire Department's Facebook page. How come you haven't liked us or friended us? Are you serious right now? You're just gonna take advantage of all this great stuff and not put a little effort in? Come on. We gotta get like 7,000 more people to follow us, because then we can beat the city of Spokane. I'm just saying. Help us out here, all right? We're working here. We're trying to get some stuff done, trying to keep people safe. Take a moment. Click, click, like, click, click, friend. Got it? Thanks a lot, guys. You're awesome. See you later.